الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله ما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله خير الهدي هدي نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. Page number 20, the manner number 4. طيب. You should not say, I forgot. Instead, say, I was made to forget. What is the difference? It is passive, صح? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith, okay, بئس ما لأحدهم يقول, the second hadith, not the first hadith, the second hadith, بئس ما لأحدهم يقول. Rich is to it for one of them to say, I forgot such and such verse. Bits, it is a word, يعني, it is not recommended. It is something bad. طيب, disliked. When you say, نسيت, I forgot. Don't say نسيت for the Quran. What should you say? I was made to forget. The passive. طيب. And also the previous hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one night when he heard a man reciting a chapter of the Quran, he said, may Allah have mercy on him, for he has indeed reminded me of such and such verse, which I was made to forget from such and such surah. طيب. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, unsituha, not nasit. Maybe for some people, okay, what is the difference? Okay, no, there is a difference because the Prophet ﷺ made a difference. So this is forbidden to say nasit surat kada, nasit this verse, this surah. You should say I was made to forget. طيب. Why? Okay, some scholars say it because, يعني, if you say, I forgot this surah, as if you are not respecting the Quran. But if you say, I was made to forget, يعني, you are showing that this is from the shaitan. This is from the shaitan. So, we should not say, I forgot this surah or that surah. This is one of the manners of the Quran. طيب. I think we mentioned this last week, صح? طيب. So this is as a review. طيب. Number 5. It is compulsory to reflect, to contemplate the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran for us not only to read. Also we have to reflect the Quran. You should think about the Quran. And this is wajib. This is wajib. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Do they not then consider the Qur'an carefully? Had it been from other than Allah, they would surely have found therein much contradictions. Also mentioned this last week. طيب. Also another ayah, كِتَابٌ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. This is a book, it means the Quran, which we have sent down to you full of blessings that they may ponder over its verses. So it is not enough to read the Quran again and again. It is not enough to memorize the Quran. But we have to understand the Quran. Then after understanding the Quran, you can reflect the Quran. طيب. So you have to know the Arabic language. Then you can understand the Quran. Then you can reflect the Quran. You think deeply about the Quran. This is very important. Number 6. It is allowed to read the Quran while walking, sitting, laying down. All of these positions are allowed. Why he mentioned this? Because some people think, no, if I'm reading the Quran, I should sit in an upright position and read the Quran. It is not allowed to stand up or to lie down. No, all this allowed. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ. Those who remember Allah, always and in prayers, standing, sitting and down on their sides. So this is clear. And also when you are riding, لِتَسْتَوُوا عَلَى ظُهُورِهِ ثُمَّ تَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ رَبِّكُمْ إِذَا اسْتَوَيْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ وَتَقُولُوا سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي سَخَّرَ لَنَا هَذَا وَمَا كُنَّا لَهُ مُقْرِنِينَ وَإِنَّا إِلَى رَبِّنَا لَمُنْقَلِبُونَ. In order that you may mount firmly on their backs. And the same thing, the car. Camels, donkeys, cars, horses. Okay? Then you say the dua. And this dua from the Quran. سبحان الذي سخر لنا هذا وما كنا له مقرنين. This is from the Quran. So this is allowed. This is allowed. And also, he mentioned hadith, Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها said, on the day of the, the next hadith, while I would be menstruating, the Prophet ﷺ would recline in my lap and recite the Quran. Alayhi salatu wa salam. So you can recite the Quran. You are driving, you are on bed, you are on the furniture, you are walking, you can recite the Quran. Not only in the masjid and sitting in the masjid, in any place. Alhamdulillah, this is allowed. Number seven. لا يمس المصحف إلا طاهر. طيب. Only the purified may touch the Quran. Okay, be careful. In this point, we are talking about to touch the Quran. Not reading the Quran, touching the Quran. With reading or without reading. What is the rule? The Prophet ﷺ said, لا يمس, sorry, before that, there is a verse. لا يمسه إلا المطهرون. طيب, which that book with Allah, none can touch but the purified. طيب, if you notice between brackets, he wrote what? The angels. It means the angels. It is not written in the ayah. It is not written in the verse. But we can understand from the ayah, it means the angels. It means the angels. So this ayah, it is not a clear proof for this rule. This ayah, it is not clear proof. But the hadith is very clear. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Allah yamassu al-Quran illa tahir." And that none, وعليكم السلام, and that none touch the Quran except for the purified. So the hadith is clear. And the hadith is authentic by Sheikh al-Albani, rahimahullah, and other scholars. طيب, majority of scholars said this is wajib. Majority of scholars, Ahnaf, Malikiyya, Shafi'iyya, Hanabila, okay, the four madahib say it is compulsory. You make wudu before touching the Quran. And few scholars say this is allowed. Okay? Few scholars said this is allowed. Tayyib. He mentioned a question. Is it permissible for one who is in state of impurity to hold the Quran via a barrier, such as a piece of cloth or the cloth of one's garment? يعني for example, this is the Quran. So can I hold the Quran by my qutra? This is considered as a barrier. So I hold the Quran this way. طيب, I don't touch directly the Quran. There is a barrier, the qutra. طيب. Or they say like علاقه. علاقه, يعني it is like a chain, you know. Sometimes you hold your keys by a chain. Can I hold it by, or a bag? Okay. What they say? They say yes, one may hold the Quran via a barrier because in doing so, one is not physically touching the Quran. Because the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah yamas. Okay. And that none touch the Quran except for the purified. What does it mean? Touch? means direct, skin to the book. So if there is barrier, then it is okay. If there is barrier, then it is okay. طيب. Then there is a point after that. Can you put the Quran in your pocket? I put the Quran here inside this pocket. طيب. They said, yes, this is allowed. But don't go inside the toilet. Don't go to the toilet and the Quran in your pocket. طيب. But for example, if you are in a place, people steal. Can people steal? Is it, can you imagine people steal the Quran? Yes. I remember one of the sheikh, he was teaching us this chapter, a chapter for purity. He said he was in a country, I will not mention the name of the country, with his friend, and they kept the Quran outside, then they went inside the toilet. I did not say. He said they stole the Quran. He went outside and they stole the Quran. Yeah, imagine, I think he was a student to get the PhD. This was before maybe 25 years. Yeah, before 25 years, the mobiles were not available. The mobiles were not available. So from where he can revise the Quran? He needs the Quran. Okay? Now it's okay, it is in the mobile. So if there is darura, if it is necessary, you keep the Quran, okay, go inside the toilet. But mainly you should keep it outside with your friend, with your wife, okay? Okay. طيب, but you have to be careful. You put the Quran here, you say it in your pocket. But if you are wearing a trouser, don't keep it on the back, because usually in the trousers, there is a pocket at the back. Okay? This is very bad. You keep your pocket in the back. The Quran. And maybe you sit on this Quran, you are not respecting the Quran. Okay? So you should be careful. You should be careful. طيب. Number 8. It is allowed to recite the Quran without wudu. It is allowed to recite the Quran without wudu. Why? Because there is hadith, what is the proof? There is hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam woke up at night. وَمَسَحَ النَّوْمَ عَنْ وَجْهِهِ. If you remember, we mentioned this hadith. وَمَسَحَ, he wiped his face. He is removing the sleepiness from his face. Then he recited, which ayat? Ali Imran, the last. Ayat inna fi khalq al-samawati wal-ard wa ikhtilafi al-layl wal-nahar. Then he made the wudu. So scholars said it is allowed to recite the Quran without wudu. We are not talking about touching the Quran, about reading the Quran. So it is allowed to read the Quran without wudu. It is allowed to read the Quran without wudu. Tamam? Hadith is clear. طيب. But what he said here, he said, أَمَّا الْجَنَابَةِ, if one is janaba, in a major state of impurity, this results from an instance from engaging in sexual intercourse or having a wet dream. طيب, it is categorically forbidden for him to recite the Quran, which means that he may neither touch the Quran and read from it directly, nor recite it from memory. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, the Messenger of Allah would recite the Quran to us as long as he was not junub. He was not junub. طيب. He mentioned here a point that for the janabah, your major impurity, it is not allowed to read the Quran from the book, from the Quran or from the memory. Why? He mentioned a hadith. Some scholars said, no, it is allowed. Why? Because number one, this hadith is not authentic.
Yes, some scholars said it is authentic, other scholars said not authentic. Yeah, like Sheikh Albani said, it is not an authentic hadith. The other point, even when if we say this hadith is authentic, if we agree this hadith is authentic, okay, what is the hadith? The hadith tells us something from the action of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or from the saying of Rasulullah?
Action.
This is an action from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in usul al-fiqh, if you study usul al-fiqh, the scholars say the actions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam tell us that it is mustahab, it is recommended. And the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam tell us that it is compulsory, wajib. يعني for example we have a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the boy, يا غلام سمي الله وكل بيمينك وكل مما يليك. Say Bismillah. Eat by your right hand. So we can say it is compulsory, it is mandatory to say Bismillah before eating. تمام؟ But if there is hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam likes to eat by his three fingers. So we say this is mustahab. It is recommended to eat by three fingers. And it is okay if you eat by the five fingers or four, not necessarily five, four. Tamam? So this hadith talks about the action of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So number one, we say the hadith is not, some scholars say the hadith is not authentic. And second point, it is an action. So we'll say it's better to make ghusl than you recite the Quran. Tamam? Then he mentioned a point. You can recite the Quran, inshallah. Okay, because we don't have a clear proof that reading the Quran for the junub is haram. Because this is an action. Even when you say it is hadith, authentic, but it is an action. So you can recite the three quls before going to sleep. Tamam? There is a point he mentioned that which is better? You read the Quran from your memory or from the Mus'haf? For example, you are Hafid. You are Hafid. You Hafid Quran from Surah Al-Fatiha until Surah Al-Nas. Now you want to read Quran. You are sitting at home or in the masjid between Maghrib and Isha or after Fajr. So which is better? You open the Mus'haf and you read from the Mus'haf, or you close the Mus'haf and you read from your memory? Tayyib. Alaykum salam. Some scholars said from your memory, other scholars said from the Mus'haf. We have a hadith, it is not mentioned here. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Sheikh Al-Bani mentioned this hadith, من سره أن يحب الله ورسوله فليقرأ من المصحف. If you want to get the love of Allah and the love of Rasulullah, read from the Mus'haf. Okay? So this hadith gives us that it's recommended to read from the Mus'haf, not from your memory. Okay. Some scholars said, as he mentioned, Ibn Kathir said, and some scholars said, it depends. We will not give a general rule. They say it depends. What do they mean? They mean, if you feel that I have more concentration when I open the Mus'haf, then we tell you, read from the Mus'haf. But another brother said, no, I feel khushu', I feel concentration more when I read from my memory. We tell you, read from your memory.
Okay? SubhanAllah, people like this. If they hold the mushaf, okay, mashallah, their khushu', their concentration is more. Other people know when they close the mushaf and they read from their memory, they feel concentration more. It depends. So you do what is more comfortable. When you have more concentration. But if you, for example, if you say, "Wallahi, I concentrate more if I read from my memory," it doesn't mean that you don't read from the mushaf. Open the mushaf. Don't leave the mushaf. Read from the mushaf. For example, you read one page from the mushaf and the other pages from your memory. Don't keep the mushaf at home without reading. Open them. Number 9, it is allowed for the women during the period to read the Quran. To read the Quran. But without touching the Quran. We tell the sisters during the period, you can revise your memory. Yeah, especially for those who are Quran teachers. They say, what we can do during the Quran, during the period? 5 days, 6 days, 7 days, or after the giving birth, 35 days. We tell them, you can read the Quran, but don't touch the mushaf. Don't touch the mushaf. Okay, if she says, I don't memorize the Quran, what can I do? They say, you can hold the tafsir. You can hold the tafsir. Or you can use the computer, the iPad, the laptop. Why? Because the laptop is not Quran. The mobile is not Quran. So you can use the mobile, the laptop, the iPad to read. So this is allowed for the woman. This is allowed for the woman. Number, are you okay? Tamam? Sisters, okay? Tamam. Number 10. It is recommended to clean one's mouth with siwak before reciting the Quran. Clean your mouth before reciting the Quran. طيب. He mentioned hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to clean his mouth for qiyam al-layl at night. When he wakes up at night, he used to clean his mouth. طيب. There is another hadith, not in the book, mentioned by Sheikh Albani in Sahih al-Jami'. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, طَيِّبُ أَفْوَاهَكُمْ بِالسِّوَاكِ فَإِنَّهَا طُرُقُ الْقُرْآنِ. Clean and purify your mouths by siwak. Why? Because they are the paths or the ways of the Quran. When you read the Quran, okay, through your mouth. So clean your mouth for the Quran. So it is mustahab to clean your mouth for the Quran. It is mustahab to clean your mouth, okay, your teeth, your siwak, by siwak for the Quran. So this is a good point for the Muslims who smoke cigarettes. Okay? Yani, of course, number one, we tell them, please, you should stop, quit smoking. Stop smoking cigarettes. This is haram. This is harmful for your health. So stop smoking cigarettes. Then if they did not follow our advice, we tell them, go to the second level, the next stage. Don't smoke cigarettes before the salah. Okay, please. Don't smoke cigarettes before coming to the masjid or before reciting the Quran. طيب. And try your best and ask the help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 11. من السنة الاستعادة والبسملة عند التلاوة. It is sunnah to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. It is sunnah to say A'udhu billah min ash-shaytan rajim. When you recite the Quran, Allah says in the Quran, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. So when you want to recite the Quran, seek refuge with Allah from Shaytan, the outcast. طيب. How you say the isti'adha? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you notice the hadith, أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه. In the next page, the page number 29, I seek refuge with Allah, the all-hearing and all-knowing, from the accursed shaitan, from his pride, his poetry and his madness. So this is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the isti'adha. A'udhu billahi sami' al-alim min ash-shaytan rajim min hamzihi wa nafthihi wa nafthihi. Or there is another narration. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim min hamzihi wa nafthihi wa nafthihi. Yani without saying sami' al-alim. Okay? Tamam? Here he mentioned, what are the ways to say A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim? Number one, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim. Number two, أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزي ونفخي ونفثه. Or we can add, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم من همزي ونفخي ونفثه. You can add this. يعني without saying السميع العليم. In the book he mentioned number three, أعوذ بالسميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. أعوذ بالسميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. But this is not authentic hadith. There is hadith, but it is not authentic. طيب. If you notice in the footnotes, he mentioned that Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen mentioned this statement. But he did not say that Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen said it is authentic. Sheikh Albani mentioned it is not authentic. طيب. So it is not authentic narration. Sharp في ماي sharp ماي طيب أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم from where from the Quran مشكور أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم from the Quran تمام but from the Sunnah أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم من همزي ونفخي ونفثي or أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزي ونفخي ونفثي تمام so this is the way of the استعادة. طيب. What about بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم? Okay, it is Sunnah because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was with the companions one day. Then he smiled and he recited بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصلي لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر. So he mentioned the Basmala. And if you noticed, he did not say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. It means the استعادة مستحبة or واجبة. No. مستحبة. In the hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم started with بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. He did not say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. So it means saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم compulsory or recommended only? It is recommended. مستحب only. Okay? Clear? طيب. He mentioned that a common point, which is saying صدق الله العظيم after the recitation of the Quran. He said, huh? No, we said it's sunnah, recommended. Both of them recommended, not compulsory. طيب. Next point, he said, as a question, people used to say صدق الله العظيم after reciting the Quran. People say, used to say صدق الله العظيم. The answer, there is no, page 31, there is no proof. There is no proof for it. It is common. Radio, TV, schools, everywhere. After we finish the Quran, صدق الله العظيم. From where? What is the proof? The radio. What is the proof? TV. What is the proof? The school. Okay, this is not enough proof. صدق الله العظيم, it should be from the Quran or Sunnah. If it is not in the Quran or Sunnah, so please, don't say صدق الله العظيم every time you finish the recitation of the Quran. تمام؟ نعم. The same thing, after we finish the hadith, we say صدق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. It is not sunnah. It is not sunnah. Okay? The scholars narrate the hadith without saying صدق رسول الله. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم recited the Quran, the companions recited the Quran without saying صدق الله العظيم. And subhanAllah, it is difficult for our children. Very difficult for our children. Why? Because they used to say صدق الله العظيم. Even the teachers, they teach them, why you are not saying صدق الله العظيم? So they feel bad, because I am the only student who is not saying صدق الله العظيم. So he put a statement from one of the great scholars, Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad. Okay, Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad said, subhanAllah, in the middle of page 31, Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, Rahimahullah, said, is known for some profound epigrammatic sayings. In one such saying, he said, what he said, Fidayim Iyad, don't feel lonely on the paths of guidance just because few people travel them. And don't be deceived by the abundance of destroyed travelers. Tayyib, this is, subhanAllah, very important. I remember, subhanAllah, my teacher, Dr. Ibrahim, he was teaching me pharmacy. Any problem? It's okay. He was teaching in the faculty of medicine, teaching us the pharmacology. طيب. He's originally from Cyprus, Qubrus, but with the American passport. I think he left Kuwait maybe before 5 or 7 years. So he was telling me his story. His wife from Turkey, he said, my wife was the only woman in the village with hijab. Subhanallah. She was the only lady with hijab in the village. I don't know, it was a small village, big village, subhanallah. Yani, this is not easy. Imagine you are the only man in the village or in the city with beard, or the only woman with niqab, the only woman with hijab. Tayyib, subhanAllah, this is not easy, but don't care. Don't care. Because you are following the haqq. You are following the haqq. Everyone is saying صدق الله العظيم. I should say صدق الله العظيم with them? No. Don't say صدق الله العظيم with them. Of course, يعني, if they are not harming you, what will happen? Tayyib, people should know the sunnah. If they don't know the sunnah through you, from where they know the sunnah? If you say صدق الله العظيم with them, how can they know the sunnah? So you should follow the haqq in a wise way. طيب. So people will say, what should we say after the Quran? You should not say anything. Okay. Many times when we stop people from doing bid'ah or saying bid'ah, they ask for something to substitute, replace. It is not a must. Yeah, for example, people used to say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم after yawning. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. This is not sunnah.
So we tell them, it is not sunnah to say, A'udhu billahi shaitan rajim. They will ask, okay, what should we say? You should not say anything. Tell us. After sneezing, okay, we should say, Alhamdulillah. But after yawning, don't say anything. طيب, what should we say after the end of the Quran? We should not say anything. طيب, but he mentioned a hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He asked Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, please recite the Quran for me. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, oh Rasulullah, Allah revealed the Quran on you. And you want to hear the Quran from me? The Prophet ﷺ said, I like to hear the Quran from someone else. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud started to recite some verses from Surah An-Nisa. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. Then the Prophet ﷺ told Ibn Mas'ud, Hasbuk, please stop. So the Prophet ﷺ did not tell Ibn Mas'ud, say صدق الله العظيم. He told somebody, he said, stop, khalas. Then Abdullah Mas'ud noticed that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was crying. It was crying, alayhi salatu wassalam. Dinner's ready? Okay. Shall we have a break? 10 minutes, then we'll continue.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabi. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله ما بعد. طيب. Which point now? Point number 12. تمام. Point number 12. Page number 33. طيب. It is recommended to recite the Quran clearly and slowly. And it is disliked to recite it quickly and carelessly. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. And recite the Quran loudly in a slow, pleasing tone and style. If you remember, I mentioned last week and also when we spoke about Shaman Muhammadiyah, the levels of reciting the Quran, about the speed. There is tartil, okay, then, which is faster, not hadr, there is in between. Hadr is the third one. Tadweer. Okay, it is called tadweer. Tartil, then tadweer, then hadr. Tayyib? Hadr is fast. But it doesn't mean fast you don't follow the rules of tajweed. You have to follow the rules of tajweed in all kinds of recitation. You have to follow the rules of tajweed. Okay, it doesn't mean that you like to read fast. I don't follow the rules of tajweed. You have to follow. Okay. The rules of tajweed. Some scholars said it is wajib to follow the rules of tajweed. Other scholars said no, it is not wajib. Which they mean the. I mean the rules of tajweed, يعني like الإخفاء, إقلاب, الإدغام. طيب, these are, sorry. طيب, some scholars said it is wajib, other scholars said it is not wajib. يعني for example, there are rules. There are rules of tajweed, يعني for example, idgham. Okay, idgham اللي هو الادغام والاقلاب والاخفاء والاظهار. مثلا هل ينظرون. What is the word in Arabic? Okay, we say ينظرون. ينظر. ينظر. ينظر to see, okay, but in tajweed we say ينظرون, ينظر like this, okay. So we try to mix or to melt the noon letter with ضاء, صح؟ ينظر. This is called إخفاء. Some scholars said this kind of tajweed mustahab. Other scholars said no, this is wajib, compulsory. You have to follow this rule. طيب. Sheikh Uthaymeen said this, it is not wajib. Sheikh Uthaymeen mentioned it is not wajib. Even you can notice the recitation of some scholars in Unayza and Saudi, they don't follow the rules of tajweed because I think they believe it is not compulsory. Okay, but there are some kinds, there is something important, which is the rules of Arabic. You have to follow the rules of Arabic. يعني the fatha and dhamma. You have to follow them. يعني for example, تبت يدا أبي لهب وتب ما أغنى عنه ما له وما كسب. No, not ما له, ما له, لو. لازم, you have to say لو. It is haram to say ما له. No, it is haram. طيب. So the grammar, you have to follow the grammar, the Arabic words, the Arabic statements, the Arabic grammar, you have to follow. Okay. So when we say the fast recitation with following the rules of Arabic and Tajweed, this is okay. This is okay. Okay, but you are reading fast without following the rules? No, it's not accepted. It's not accepted. Why? Because why you are reading fast? Because I want to finish quickly. No, this is not the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He mentioned something from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. طيب, if you notice then the next page, Nuhayk ibn page 34. In the middle, Nuhayk ibn Sinan once went to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and asked, "Oh Abu Abdurrahman, how do you read this letter as an alif or a ya in the verse? It is min min ma'in ghayri asin, or min ma'in ghayri yasin, يعني ya or a." طيب قال عبد الله بن مسعود وكل القرآن قد أحصيت غير هذا. He said, do you know the whole Quran except this ayah? He said, I read al-mufassal fi rak'ah. This man Nuhayk said to Ibn Mas'ud, I read al-mufassal. Mufassal means from Surah Al-Hujurat until the end of the Quran. So about four chapters, يعني about 80 pages or 85 pages in one rak'ah. Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud wondered, يعني, it's too much. He said, "Haddan kahadd al-shi'r." He said, "Haddan kahadd al-shi'r." This is like the quick, hurried reading of poetry. طيب. Then Abdul Mas'ud said, "Inna aqwaman yaqra'u al-Qur'an la yujawizu taraqiyahum." طيب. There are people who recite the Quran, but it doesn't pass their collar bones. However, if the Quran enters the heart and becomes firm therein, it benefits. Okay, it means, what is the use? In one rak'ah, I am reading 80 pages? Yani maybe in 2 hours? 2 hours, you are reading 4 chapters from the Quran? This is too fast. It's too fast, no use. Okay, you will not understand. So the way of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is to read the Quran carefully. And this is the way of also of the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And also the same thing, Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Abu Hamza related that he said to Ibn Abbas, I am indeed quick in my recitation, where I read the entire Quran in 3 days. To which Ibn Abbas rejoined, for me to read Al-Baqarah in one night, but to contemplate it and recite it clearly and slowly is more beloved to me than for me to recite the recitation that you described. And imagine 3 days. So it means every day how many chapters? Or how many? 10 parts. How many pages? 200 pages. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, no, Baqarah in one day. Baqarah, how many pages? 50 pages. Okay, so it means 1/4. This is more beloved to me. The issue, the point is not I want to read as much as I can without understanding, without reflecting. No, I need to read the Quran carefully with deep thinking. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants this. Ibn Miflih rahimahullah mentioned, Imam Ahmad said, I like smooth, flowing recitation and I dislike speed in recitation. طيب, this is Imam Ahmad. On another occasion, when he was asked about a fast-paced recitation of the Quran, Imam Ahmad said that he disliked it, except if one speech pattern in general is such that he cannot go slower. Yes, subhanAllah, people are different. People are different. Also, yeah, Imam Ahmed, mashallah, he is Imam. Some people, when you chat with them, they are very fast. Difficult to catch. Even you notice some shuyukh. Some shuyukh, subhanAllah, when you listen to their lectures, difficult to catch with them. Okay, for example, Sheikh bin Baz. Some people, I mean the Arabs, when they listen to Sheikh bin Baz, we don't catch with him everything. Also, one of his students, Sheikh Abdul Aziz Rajhi. Okay, the same way. Okay, but other scholars, for example, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, no, he's speaking clearly, word by word, not fast. Sheikh Al Albani also, not fast. Okay, subhanAllah, this is the way of some people. They speak fast, they speak slow. So, if the person is usually speaking fast, and he's reciting the Quran, of course, fast, but with tajweed. With the rules of Quran and rules of Arabic, then Imam Ahmad said, it's okay. It's okay. طيب. He mentioned a point that which is better for the reciter, to recite slowly and contemplate what he is reciting, or to recite quickly but without reciting negligently, without pronouncing them well. ابن حجر رحمه الله سيد طيب والتحقيق أن لكل من الإسراع والترتيل جهة فضل جهة فضل ابن حجر سيد depends reciting fast and reciting slowly each one has its own favor its own virtue he means when you recite fast you will get more حسنات because of the letters صح and when you read slowly it means you can reflect and understand the Quran And subhanAllah, sometimes you want to recite. Yeah, for example, in Ramadan, people like to recite, people like to finish reciting the Quran. So what you can do, you can keep for you two khatma. One khatma, I want to finish the Quran. Yeah, for example, after Fajr, khalas. I keep one recitation fast, but of course with the tajweed. So every day after Fajr, I recite 20 pages, one part, one chapter of the Quran. But after the Asr, no. I want to understand. So I read slowly. So I spend not 20 minutes, I spend maybe 1 hour for the same amount. So maybe after Fajr, you recite Surah Al-Baqarah, and also after Asr, you recite Surah Al-Baqarah. But after Fajr, in 20 minutes, after Asr, in 1 hour. Why? To achieve both of them. I want the reward of reciting the Quran and also I want the reward to understand the Quran. طيب. Number 13, he said, it is recommended to prolong certain vowels when reciting the Quran. This is called al-mid. Okay? For example, al-haqqa. How you recite al-haqqa? Al-haqqa. You have to make it 6 extension of the fingers. SubhanAllah, if you want to read the first 3 verses of Al-Haqqa, difficult. In one breath, Al-Haqqatu mal-haqqatu wa ma adraka. Not easy. Okay, not easy, but of course, the sunnah, you read verse by verse. طيب. So, prolonging the vowels, okay, this is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when reciting the Quran as Umm Salama sorry, as Anas radiallahu ta'ala mentioned this, and also Umm Salama. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Tayyib, slowly. You read with prolonging where we need to prolong. Tayyib, not to prolong the things that not need to prolong. Yani, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Some people say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is wrong. This is wrong because it should be only two extending of the fingers. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. The last one, yes, you can prolong. At the end, you can't. When you want to stop, you can prolong. Okay? Yeah, you need to study the rules of tajweed. Next point. No. The scholar said it means you prolong what is needed to prolong. يعني here you need only two. Why? Because this is called mad tabi'i, normal mad, normal prolongation. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Not Bismillah. Bismillah, this is without mad. But you have to say Bismillah. Okay, you prolong two. Mad, okay? Al-mad, at least two extending of the fingers and maximum six. So here you can do two. Why? Because it is mad tabi'i. For Bismillah. Ar-Rahman. Also it depends. If you want to stop, you can prolong it. Bismillah ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahim. You can't prolong. Why? Because you stopped. But without a stop, you cannot prolong it. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So, this is mad tabi'i if you are not stopping. Ameen. Number 14, istihbab tahsin al-sawt bil-qira'ah. It is recommended to beautify one's voice during recitation, but it is forbidden to recite in song-like manner. طيب. He mentioned hadith. Al-Bara' ibn Azib said, radiyallahu ta'ala, and I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reciting Wattini wa Zaytun during Al-Isha prayer, and I have never heard anyone that had a more beautiful voice or recitation than he did. Alayhi salatu wa salam. Also, you mentioned hadith, Allah has not heard anything similar to his hearing a prophet chant the Quran. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Beautifying the voice for the Quran. And also there is hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يَتَغَنَّ بِالْقُرْآنِ. Yes, he is not from us who doesn't chant the Quran. Okay, so it is sunnah. And maybe we can understand from this hadith, it is wajib. It is wajib. You beautify your voice for the Quran. You recite the Quran, yani, do your best when you recite the Quran, not like talking to people, not like reading a newspaper. No, read the Quran in a different way. Not the regular way. Next hadith, page in the middle, page 37. زينوا أصواتكم بالقرآن. Okay, what is written in English? In English. Mubin, you have the same version? What is written? Your voices? It is not complete. It is written beautify. I mean, in your version, it is written beautify.
No, next to that, the explanation.
Okay, the explanation. Okay, but it is incomplete. It is incomplete. Yes, beautify your voices with the Quran. طيب, this narration is not authentic narration. Sheikh Al-Albani said this is shad.
Munkar. Where? Okay. Okay. Ah, okay. Okay, it is up. Adorn, yes. Okay, in Arabic also, in the Arabic version, the hadith narrated here is not authentic. I know. Huh? No, it is correct translation. But the hadith in this version is not authentic. Shad. Sheikh Albani said this is shad. Munkar. I know, Sheikh. That's why, brothers and sisters, be careful. Don't trust these books blindly. Why? Because this is a human being. There are many mistakes in the books. Okay? The Sheikh Al-Bani mentioned the authentic narration, زَيِّنُوا الْقُرْآنَ بِأَصْوَاتِكُمْ. Beautify the Quran by your voices. Not the opposite. Because this narration, it means if I want my voice to be good and nice, I should recite the Quran to make my voice nice. This is the meaning of this hadith, but this is not authentic narration. This is odd, not authentic narration. Okay? The singers use this narration, they recite the Quran because they want voice to become good. This is not authentic. طيب. And that's why I'm saying we need to check, especially if you are talib ilm, student of knowledge, okay, try to check the ahadith and to read the sources. Okay, if you go back and you'll find in what is written, Sunan Abi Dawud, صح? And Sheikh Al-Bani said it is sahih. But if you go back, you'll find Sheikh Al-Bani did not say sahih for this narration. He said it is sahih for the other narration. Okay? We need to check. And subhanAllah, this will come with knowledge. A lot of reading, you can signify which is correct and which is not correct. Yes. Beautify the Quran with your voice. Okay? And don't read the Quran normally as you read the newspaper. Try to change your voice to something nice. And try. Don't say, wallah, I know my voice is bad. Okay? Try your best. And Allah will help you. طيب. Which is better? Well, yes, sorry. Then he mentioned a hadith from Abu Musa رضي الله تعالى عنه. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari رضي الله تعالى عنه. The night after, sorry, what is the narration? Yes, the night after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم heard Abu Musa al-Ash'ari رضي الله تعالى عنه recite the Quran, he met Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. Then he said, "Would that you had seen me when I was listening to your recitation last night? You have indeed been given a flute from the flutes of Ali Dawood, the family of Dawood." طيب يعني ما شاء الله, his recitation very nice. Abdullah Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, his name is Abdullah ibn Qais. What is the name of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari? Abdullah ibn Qais. If you see this question in the exam, what should you write? Abdullah ibn Qais. Who is Abdullah ibn Qais? Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. What is the name of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari? Abdullah ibn Qais. Okay? So please remember this information. Abdullah ibn Qais, yes. طيب. Okay, then and another narration, Abdullah ibn Qais said, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari said, had I known where you were, I would have indeed adorned my voice for you. يعني Abu Musa al-Ash'ari said, I can do more also. I can make it more beautiful for you, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, next point. What about, yes, and he mentioned in the title, that but it is forbidden to recite in song-like manner.
يعني we have to be careful not to make, not to imitate those who sing. Okay, the Quran should be, we should respect the Quran, the way of the Quran, not to make the Quran like the songs. Okay? Next point, number 15, crying when listening to the Quran or recitation of the Quran. Is it allowed or not? It is allowed. The Prophet ﷺ was crying. If you remember, we mentioned the Shamal Muhammadiyah, also the companions, and also we mentioned the hadith when Abdullah Mas'ud was reciting Surah An-Nisa. The Prophet ﷺ told him to stop. Then he saw the eyes of Rasulullah ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ was crying, and his eyes were the tears coming from his eyes, alayhi salatu wassalam. But he mentioned that wailing or shouting when you are reciting the Quran or listening to the Quran, this is not good. It's not good. And also what is common nowadays, we know people in Ramadan, during reciting the Quran, they are not crying. But when the Imam recites the dua and witr, they are crying. Why? Okay? Why? طبعا الله أعلم about why they are doing this. We don't know what is inside their hearts. But subhanAllah, you hear the Quran for 2 hours, then at the end, for 5 minutes, you cry because of the dua. It means you do not understand the Quran. SubhanAllah. He mentioned a point that you can ask others to recite the Quran. You can ask others to recite the Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked Abdullah Mas'ud. We mentioned the hadith. And what he said, I indeed desire to hear it from other than me. So for example, if we are in a meeting or we are with our family, so it is okay to ask. I ask, for example, my son, I ask my father, I ask my friend, please recite the Quran, and we listen to him. This is okay. This is okay, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, we like to hear it from others. From others. طيب. So this is allowed. And also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned a hadith, استقرئ القرآن من أربعة. Take the recitation of the Quran from four. Abdullah Mas'ud, Wasal Mawla, Abi Hudayfa, wa Ubay ibn Ka'b, Mu'ad ibn Jabal. Very good hadith for the exam. Okay? From where we should learn the Quran, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the companions, take the Quran from these four companions. طيب Abdullah Mas'ud, Wasal Mawla, Abi Hudayfa, wa Mu'ad ibn Jabal, wa Ubay ibn Ka'b. Page 41. Okay? At the top of page 41. Do you know them? Huh? Anyone can recall them? The four? Anyone? Yalla. Shabab. Sisters. Huh? Boys. Boys. Shabab. Who are the four? Yalla. عبد الله بن مسعود سالم مولى أبي حذيفة معاذ جبل أبي بن كعب ممتاز okay. سالم مولى أبي حذيفة سالم is not the son of أبو حذيفة مولى what does mean مولى he was a slave then he freed him he is called مولى طيب مولى طيب who's أبو موسى الأشعري عبد الله بن قيس تمام ما شاء الله طيب so you know these four people huh? رضي الله تعالى عنهم then he mentioned number 16 it is allowed as long as no harm results it is recommended to recite the Quran out loud طيب but he mentioned the condition don't bother others Don't harm. طيب. قال النووي رحمه الله تعالى in his book الأذكار that there are both narrations that extol the virtues of reciting out loud and narrations and extol to the virtues of reciting quietly. Yeah, some scholars said loud, some scholars said quiet. You read the Quran. If you are okay that I'm not afraid to be murai, I'm not showing, then it's okay. Recite the Quran loudly. But you should not bother the others, because this is forbidden. This is forbidden. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, وَلَا يَجْهَرْ بَعْضُكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضُ. The Quran, next page, he mentioned hadith. Each one of you is privately conversing with his Lord. So don't inflict harm upon one another. And let not some of you raise his voice in recitation over the voices of others, of the others. طيب. So this is important. You want to recite the Quran, okay? I should recite loudly or quietly. If you are afraid of show, so read it quietly. If you don't afraid of show, read it loudly. But if there are people around you, maybe sleeping, maybe reading, studying, okay, don't raise your voice. But if you are alone or they are okay, then read it loudly. طيب. So if there are people, yeah, for example, in the masjid, especially Jum'ah day, we go to the masjid Jum'ah, and you'll find some people reading not very loud, but they can't bother you. يعني الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا. يعني two, three people from the right, left, and front, back, they hear him. You cannot concentrate. Well, I sometimes, خلاص, I close the Quran and I start to listen to him. No, this is not allowed, haram. And I like to, there is another point regarding this rule about the outside amplifier of the masjid. Okay? Some imam open the amplifier. In the masjid, there is inner and outer. They open both of them. Okay? Why? Let people hear the Quran, especially in Ramadan, the Taraweeh. This is wrong. This is wrong. Why you want to open? Let people hear the Quran. Okay, people don't want to hear the Quran. Is it compulsory to hear the Quran this time? It's not compulsory. Reciting the Quran in Taraweeh in Ramadan for those people who are inside the masjid. But you open the outer amplifier, okay, and you shout, you make it very high, let people hear the Quran, then people will come to inside the masjid. This is not the sunnah. This is not the sunnah. And yani, for example, maybe it will be clear after a few years. Why? Because Ramadan will be in March. Okay, like this nowadays. If you notice nowadays, some masajid the AC is on and some masajid the AC is off. And those, if the AC is off, what do? They open the windows, صح? If they open the windows, okay, and the microphone is on, subhanallah, يعني, I remember, okay, when Ramadan was in January, something like the, or sorry, maybe in October, the weather is nice, but you need to open the windows. I hear the other masjid. His recitation, mashallah, nicer than our imam. And this is wrong, wrong. This is wrong. This is haram. This is haram. Okay? Because يعني, some people feel bad why they close, why he complained to close the microphone during the salah. Because this is not sunnah. This is not sunnah. طيب? Because sometimes also the women pray at home. The woman pray at home. So if she's praying at home and the masjid is reciting, she cannot concentrate. Okay? So please, if you are in my masjid, don't open the microphones. Or if you are inside the masjid before Jum'ah, also don't read loudly. Or even at home, if you are reading and your wife reading, don't raise your voice. Don't shout. Also, we are telling the sister, khalas. Okay, if there is fight between the husband and wife, he's raising his voice and she's raising his voice in the Quran, not through the Quran, طيب. But this is also a problem. Why he's reading the Quran? To bother his wife? This is bad intention.
They are using the Quran for fights. مشكلة هذه. طيب. He mentioned a point that if you look at the Quran by your eyes, يعني you are reading by your eyes, this is not considered reading. يعني for example, I want to understand the Quran and reflect the Quran. So I open the Quran and I look at the Quran like this. My mouth is closed. This is not reading. You will not get the reward of reading. Okay, inshallah, you'll get the reward of what? Of understanding the Quran, of reflecting the Quran. Okay, but you'll not get the reward of reading the Quran. You have to move your lips and tongues. Okay? طيب, next point, number 17. If it is sunnah to finish the Quran, to do khatmah, okay? What is the maximum and what is the minimum days? There is hadith the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned, the one who reads the Quran in less than 3 days, he will not understand the Quran. So it means it is not recommended to read the Quran in less than 3 days. And maximum, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told one of the companions, read the Quran in 40 days. 40 days. Another narration, 1 month. So we can say the limits between 3 and 40. 3 days and 40 days. Okay, if you have free time, you know how to read the Quran. Okay, so read it every 3 days. So every day, how many chapters? Or how many parts? 10 parts. Okay. You are busy, it is difficult for you to read the Quran, so we'll give you 40 days. So if it is 40 days, yeah, it means every day how many pages? About 15 pages. About 15 pages, okay? And now we said, rahimahullah, most of the salaf, most of the scholars read the Quran within 7 days. 7 days, okay? So, yeah, it depends if you are busy or not. You can read the Quran quickly or, sorry, you can read the Quran properly and it is easy for you or not. For example, for the Arabs, no doubt, generally it is easier for the non-Arabs. For those who are regularly reading the Quran, it will be easier for them. For those who are not regularly reading the Quran. Okay? So, reading the Quran between 3 and 40. The Prophet ﷺ recommends, now we mentioned that most of the scholars read within how many days? Seven days. 7 days. You will find maybe some narrations that Uthman radiallahu ta'ala used to read the Quran in one rak'ah. Not in one day, one rak'ah. Shafi'i used to read the Quran twice a day in Ramadan. طيب. Okay, the scholars are doing this, or some of the scholars and companions, they are doing this. Okay, maybe they don't know the hadith. Maybe. Okay, so we have to follow the hadith. We have to follow the hadith. The hadith said, less than 3 days, you cannot understand the Quran. Okay, and don't make it more than 40 days. Try, it is not haram. For example, if you say, well, I want to read every 2 months. Or sorry, I finish the Quran within 2 months. It is not haram, it is okay, khair, good. Okay, but to be in the sunnah, okay, between 3 and 40 days. طيب. We'll stop here. See you, inshallah.